the time as governor in from 03 to 11 was a real challenging time. I came in at the dot-com burst. Remember, this is the time before that in the early 90s. Everybody was employed that wanted to be employed. It was just a great time. I wish you all could get out of school. And that's the way it was, like it was in 2003. I mean, the market was just, the stock market was just going crazy. And people all working, and only problem is the bubble burst, and I took center stage, and I had to take us through that. And then the recession in 07, 09 was a challenge for me. And it was, I think that what most people, I've never publicly said it, but what we did in that period of time, we never had a special session on the budget. I handled it all from the executive branch. And the legislature came in on special session, but it wasn't about the budget. And to be very frank, the speaker and the president of the Senate were both glad to let me do it, because they knew if they came in on this, it was, it'd be like it is in Washington, D.C. right now. And no one wanted that, so we managed through it, for good or bad.
Even at the beginning of the governor's term, you know, there was a fully staffed Capitol Press Bureau. We did a lot of emails, but it was a lot of in-person conversations. Very rarely were you emailing statements to someone. You were talking to someone directly in the media. There was also deadlines they could push. I mean, there were many nights where I was there till 9, 10, 11 at night, and they could get something in under the wire to go to print by midnight to get out for the morning paper the next day that's actually delivered to everybody's doorstep. And so it was just a really different environment even towards the end when, you know, at that time Facebook too was non-existent, and it was just as it existed for college students. In fact, we had a Facebook page. None of us knew what to do with it. It was for your campaign. We had these college kids. We were like, whatever, do whatever you're supposed to do. And then when Facebook came to Oregon, we went to go launch a Facebook page for the governor, and they're like, you have one. I'm like, what? And we couldn't get it removed because we didn't have like the authority, and so we had tracked down. It was just funny because it was just a totally different universe.
With all due respect to the media, the truth is, I just don't think government is a good story unless it's a scandal. You know, it's just not something that anybody wants to spend a great deal of time. And I understand the readers. There's competition out there now. And I don't think the readers are necessarily very, very interested in about just good news about government, how it's working. They expect that. So there's not much of a story. And so what makes the news about the government most of the time is some sort of a scandal or something that's gone awry. So it was a change in the newspaper industry, and I think that was the beginning of the change that I saw as far as, and look, you're all students and you know this as well as I do. It was the business model that the newspapers had, which was based upon advertisement and, you know, cars and homes and things like that. And it's right now it's a struggle to get the newspaper industry to get a new business model that is actually keeps them being able to use print as a media source. The other thing was is that it came was this, what Anna was saying was the cold type. The first was just computers that worked, but then all of a sudden the internet came, and then blogs, and this whole thing just shifted, and it's a whole new. The industry, I think, it's just new to them. And not new to them, but they're having difficulty figuring out what's their place in this whole thing. And remember, historically, and probably at least two components in my lifetime, it was newspapers and radio. And then television came. And then the internet came, and blogs, and all of you are out there now trying to figure out where you're going to fit into this. And it's changed. It has changed remarkably, and it's unfortunate from my perspective, and I'm going to speak to you as a lawyer just for a second, is that, you know, the First Amendment of the Constitution has a freedom of the press, but what, have you ever asked yourself, come on, instead of me talking, why don't you tell me what you think the freedom of the press signifies? Why did they put it in there? What was the purpose of it? I mean, why? Yeah.
to keep the public informed about the truth?
That's the second piece. And I'm going to come back to that.
To hold power to account?
Yes. It was a two-pronged approach, and one was to hold the government accountable. And I think that is still the most important purpose of the press. Look, you've all heard the absolute power corrupts absolutely. It's absolutely true. I don't care if you're in government or in your private business. It's the same way. That's just the nature of institutions. But the government, I can't do much about corporations in the private sector, but I can tell you the government has to be held accountable. And they have to be aggressive, the press, in doing that. And it's sometimes a very tough relation. I got upset. The press got upset at me, and I got upset at them. But the other piece that I'm going to get to is the other issue is it is your responsibility, the media, to educate and inform the public of the issues of the day so they can make a reasonable decision on those issues. They have a right to get the truth. And in an era of alternative facts, and this great one which I still haven't worked through my mind, I didn't take him literally, I took him figuratively. I never was smart enough to tell the press that. Well, you're just taking me literally. I will never figure it. But I'm telling you, it's terribly confusing to the public. And they don't know what to believe. And so you help me work myself through this because I am very confused about how a citizen can make a rational choice about an issue or a candidate, given the way that we promote government today. When I first got in the early 70s, every newspaper in this state believed it was important to have, and I'll use this phrase, a seasoned reporter in the Capitol when the legislature was in session. It was a very important issue with the media to have a reporter there, not a streamer, a reporter representing the newspaper. And this is not the way it is in every state, but in Oregon, one of the great ironies of it was the power of the editorial pages, if you were running for office, was not the Oregonian. It was a series of these very crusty, hardcore editors that ran the local newspapers. But what they did is they brought in some of the best reporters I've ever dealt with. And it was not, it's a different environment, and I do not believe in using today's standards to judge what happened then. But they basically, when they would come to you, there would be a story and a deadline, because they were going to get the paper the next morning. What they wanted more than anything was, give us the background. We're not going to quote you. Just tell us what's going on. And, you know, there's a natural relationship between a reporter asking a politician a question. We're both gaming each other. They want me to be as absolutely truthful with them, and I'm making sure I don't say anything that gets me in trouble. Either they write something bad or anything else. But the fact is it used to be that there was a great deal of confidence in people like myself to tell them. I says, listen, this doesn't bother me, but I can tell you all this and this and this and this. And they then would go out and actually do the groundwork and find the story. But what they were more interested in is what was happening. And remember, at that time, there was not like it is today, where in every agency, there's an unauthorized stringer of an employee as a contact with a reporter who tells them what's going on inside. And what they have to do is the press just has to make a decision, how important is this and how much of it's just a gripe or something like that. But it used to be that it was always about trying to get the whole picture of this issue, whatever it was. So ideas are powerful, and policy is very, very important. And I understand why the media is interested in those issues, but there's an overarching issue in this country today, which it seems to be we're just walking past in the night. And that is the division in this country. I mean, you know as much as I do about this, but I would guess it's fairly close to 50-50. You know, the president has 50% of the people probably cheering him on. And the dilemma isn't the differences. It is this idea that there's no middle ground. It's either this or that. It's either I'm right, you're wrong, or we don't do anything. A nation of 400 million people, as diverse as it is, you can't just sit and say, we're not going to do anything. And the issue to me is, how do we find a way to get people, once again, keep your beliefs, but find the concept of working toward a solution, giving a little. I mean, compromise is a dirty word today. It's, you're not really truthful. You really don't believe that. And you can't function like this. And when you ask me about D.C., I think this is a reflection of what's happening all across the country. It even happens in Salem. Not to the degree it is in D.C., but it's this idea. I have to win every time. And that is not the nature of this system. That's what all the checks and balances are about. Well, it's not about checks and balances. It's about shared power, shared responsibility. And if the branches don't come together and actually work toward that, I don't know where this all goes. Look, the media has a tremendous responsibility in this. And Anna didn't tell you the question you asked me, and I'm going to tell you, I was not a good person to work for from Anna's perspective, because I didn't want him to talk to the press. I must tell you this, if I had to go it all over again, if there was any one thing I would do differently, I would change my attitude to the press. I really would. And I think the media knows that the last...
You talked to us less? More?
No, it's the second part that I'm after. And I now realize not only was I shooting myself in the foot, but I wasn't doing what I should have been doing, was educating the public about these issues and telling them about them. I mean, there were a number of things we did, which, I mean, the healthy kids thing, you know, we ended up insuring 98% of all the children in the state. And the press wanted to talk. I didn't want to talk about it. I didn't want to talk to them. I wanted to talk about it, but I didn't want to talk to them. And that's my problem, because I didn't let the public know. And the public needs to know, particularly who asked the question about today, they've got to know the government does do good things. This is important. I mean, do you know what the dilemma for us is? Is that everything that government does, it isn't because the private sector wants to do it and we won't let them. Do you know how hard it is to deal with all of the problems of our human nature? Poverty, race, every single thing. Government gets that in their lap. And we try to live with it and work with it.